All right, let's jump into this. Today we are looking at Titus chapter 1, verse 5. But before we look at that again, I don't want to tell you, there's this tendency in my life to where I underestimate people. Do you have that same tendency? Where you underestimate someone. This happened pretty profoundly for me. You know, school starting back has got me thinking about when I used to be a high school teacher, and there are so many things about that I miss. One of my favorite things that I just loved about teaching at the high school is the kids were old enough that I could mess with them and not feel bad about it. And so I just loved giving them a hard time. They loved giving me a hard time, but it was usually kind of unfair as the adult who had a little bit more experience than them. But there was one time when I seriously underestimated them because I love to pull pranks on them, just mess around with them and all this stuff. I had so many of them convinced that there was just this gag reflex that was just anytime someone hugged me, I would throw up. And so I had a lot of them genuinely afraid because they were like, why can't you hug us, Mr. Franklin? And there's all these reasons. But I'd convinced them because I throw up anytime someone hugs me. All kinds of issues with my wife, you just wouldn't believe. But some of them actually believed me. But one day, I'm sitting in my class. I just had a class leave, and so I'm in my planning periods where you get some time to actually grade papers and all this stuff. So it's just me alone in my room, and I had this cart that I had petitioned for, and I got this cart that had all of these tablets. So it has tablets, but it locks. And so the way that this cart works is each tablet slides into a slot, and they're all in there, kind of packed in there in two rows, but there's also a charger that connects them, and that links to the whole cart and goes into the wall, and there's a master lock. And so it's a big deal because they want to protect the tablets, so every one of them had one of those massive OtterBox things on it. And so they don't actually fit how they're supposed to. You had to get them just right and push it in there and then hope that you didn't make the cable come out so it would charge and all this stuff. And so it was this huge ordeal to get them in and out of the iPad cart. And so my class before this had just used them. We had them all back in there. This is a big deal to get them in this stupid thing. And now it's in there. I'm alone in the room and suddenly I hear beep, 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 beep. Beep, 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 beep. Beep, beep, beep. I'm looking around is that? It's not my phone. And I realize, it's coming from the iPad cart. So I walk over to the iPad cart and I'm like, oh, one of these goofy kids has somehow set an alarm. And so I take it out and I'm putting my ear up to it, the one ear that can hear things, trying to figure out which one of them it is because I don't want to pull out every one of these things and go through this whole process again. I pull out a few and I finally get the one, why in the world is an alarm on? I get it in there, lock everything back up, go back to my desk. A few minutes later, beep, 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 beep. I go through the whole process again. Disable this alarm on the, and now I'm starting to think, what are the odds that two of these would somehow have an alarm set? I get back to my desk, beep, 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 beep. And then I realize, this is on purpose. They have done this. Every one of these iPads is going off at a different time. And so I have to take every one of them out, disable all these alarms, and just remember thinking they got me. And actually, I did not expect that. I underestimated them. And you better believe, unless they're listening to this podcast, they will not know, ever. I would not give them the satisfaction of admitting they got me. So we underestimate people sometimes. And that's what we find ourselves here. Because we underestimate sometimes what other people can do. And so our tendency is to think, no one can do it like me, right? No one can do it like me. We can view things like, I have to do it, or it's just not going to get done, or it's not going to get done right. Or we could actually trust other people to do something. We have that option. Then we can view things like, I'm the only one who can do it, or I can trust someone else. And so this is where we find ourselves in Paul's letter to Titus. Titus, he says this in verse 5. So remember, Paul has introduced himself and then said, this is to Titus. And now he says, verse 5, the reason I left you in Crete was to set right what was left undone, and as I directed you, to appoint elders in every town. So here's the thing. Paul could have considered himself to be the only one capable of getting the job done, but he doesn't. And that's what discipleship is about. Discipleship is about pointing people to God, not acting like we are God or expecting other people to be God who are not God. Did you hear that? Discipleship is about pointing people to God. It's not us pretending to be God or trying to act like God or assuming and putting the weight of expecting someone else who is not God to act like God. Discipleship is about pointing to God. It's following after him, pointing to him. And it's, please hear that. Discipleship is about knowing who God really is and pointing to him. It's not you pretending to be him, and it's not you expecting others to be him who is not him. Only God can be God. Your spouse is not going to live up to the weight of expectations if you think that they're going to be your savior and make your life awesome. Your child is not. Courtney and I just started reading this book on parenting together, and we're like barely into it, but it's just been so good for us. And one of the points the author makes right off the get-go is, he says, a lot of people come to parenting like it's their form of identity. Like you parent for identity, and that you look to your kids and their performance as a marker, a benchmark of who you are. And so when they succeed, it's like, oh, yes. Ah. And when they fail, it's defeating. It's crushing. Because their performance is your identity. And so we're looking to that. And that's terrible. You're going to take their failures personally. And I can resonate with that so many things. But we have to see ourselves in the right position of who we really are and the position that we actually hold. And our position, follower of Jesus, your position is that you are an ambassador. You are an ambassador. You are not the one making the decision. You are not the one who's actually in control. You are not the one whose will is to be done. You are a representative of the one who is in control. You are a representative of the one you are to point to. You're not to pretend to be that person, but you're to represent that person. And that person is God. And so we are not God, and we're not expecting anyone else to be God who is not God. We are just ambassadors. And so we are pointing to him. And so that, I bring all that up because that is what Paul is doing here with Titus. Paul is telling Titus, I trust you, and I'm delegating to you. And so he says, as I direct you, and this shows that this is not without direction, it's not without any kind of coaching, it's not done in a flippant way, but in an intentional way, Paul is telling Titus, this is what I'm entrusting you to do. I'm saying, you can do this. I don't need to be here. You can do this, Titus. But he gives him some coaching in that. He's not just like, oh yeah, figure it out. You can do it. He gives him some coaching. It's as I direct you. And so there are two intentionalities that I want us to see here quickly today. There's an intentionality of the plan, and there's an intentionality of the place. And so the intentionality of the plan, I want you to see that Paul trusts Titus, he then invests in Titus, and then he delegates to Titus. And so we have to ask, well, what is Paul delegating to Titus? It's continuing discipleship and appointing elders in each town. He said, the reason I left you in Crete was to set right what was left undone, and as I directed you, to appoint elders in every town. He's saying, keep discipleship going. Raise up others that you can entrust this gospel to. Continue. Multiply. Elders in each town, not just here, but multiply. And so remember, discipleship is about multiplication, not addition. We're not just adding to. It's every person we disciple. It's this understanding that they will then disciple others, and it becomes exponential. And this is what Jesus did, right? He had this circle of close friends, the 12, and he's pouring into them. But then there are crowds of thousands that will gather, and he's pouring into them. But then he brings it back to his 12. And then even within that, he pulls it back to these three that are in this inner circle. And he's investing in various levels. And why? Because Jesus, who was God, but also man. So there are limitations here. And so I'll invest in these, but invest in them in such a way that they are then going to go invest in others. And that's how discipleship, that's how the church grows. And so do not think because you don't have a big platform that you have no influence. You just invest in the ones that God has entrusted to you. Invest in them. And so discipleship is about multiplication, not addition. And so Titus is being told, as he's directed, like, you're going to go set right what was left undone, and you're going to appoint elders in each town. And so what does it mean that Titus is appointing elders in each town? You may not know this, but and it may be confusing. Like, if you see some of the pastors here will come up, and their name will come up, and it'll say, like Josh Englert, pastor/elder, community pastor/elder. I mean, which is it? Is he a pastor? Is he an elder? He's both. Because in Scripture, an elder is a pastor. They are synonymous. Bishop, overseer, shepherd, they're all synonymous. It's this position that is a pastor is what our culture likes to call it. And so Paul is telling Titus, go set up, appoint pastors in each of these churches in all of these towns. Set it up. So there's a structure here. And so what I want you to see, like if he's saying that you set right what was left undone, you appoint elders, he's saying there is a structure for this. This is an intentionality. You're creating a structure. And so church, there should be a structure to church. And Paul actually says in his letter to the church in Corinth that God is not the God of chaos, but of order. And so there should be structure. There should be order to what we do. It's not just a flippant like, oh yeah, we'll just figure it out. Like, no, we do want to have room for the Spirit to move and guide us. So we're not locked in on our decisions, but God is a God of order. And so there is structure. And then he says in each town, you're appointing elders in each town. And that means each town says there's a church there. That means there's a structure and there's a plan, there's an intentional plan to plant more churches, to have multiplying churches, because elders exist or pastors exist only because churches exist. You don't have a pastor if there is not a church. And so what we see here is that Paul is saying, Titus, this is the intentional plan. You're gonna go help all these churches multiply, plant more churches, have pastors, give structure to these churches. And so if there's an intentionality in the plan, meaning there is a purpose in the process, what is our plan? Like, beloved church, what is our plan as a church? And it's captured in our vision. If you've never read our vision or heard us talk about our vision, what we are hoping and longing and praying to see happen in the life of this church, in these people, not in organization, but in the life of you, it's to relentlessly love city after city by planting churches where people can belong, be known, and be loved. Over and over and over. And this happens by discipling each other to love God and to love each other, which is what Jesus told us to do. To love him and love each other. And so that is why, church, we have such an emphasis on the scriptures that every time we gather, you are going to hear the very word of God. That we're going to base our decisions on the word of God. That we're going to submit in all things to the word of God. It has authority over our lives because it is from God himself. And so we submit to that, and that's why we put such an emphasis on the scriptures. It's why we put such an emphasis on actually living out what it is to follow Jesus as his disciples. And so we have a monthly discipline that we highlight. So this month we've been talking about simplicity. And so we do that because we want to actually practice the way of Jesus. That we don't just make this confession one time and, oh, call it good. No, we actually follow him in that. And Jesus said to follow him. And so we do. It's why we want to be hyper-relational, building genuine community. And not just a place where people can kind of slip in and out unknown. But we want you to actually belong and be known, because that is when you will be loved. And know that you are loved in spite of your failures, in spite of my failures, that I'm loved and I belong and I'm known, because that is the gospel, that God knew me through and through. Every failure. And yet he loved me so much that he died for me. It says, I know you, and you belong, and I love you. And so we want to do that for each other. It's why I personally spend a huge portion of my time just developing leaders. Because we want to multiply the church, to plant more churches. And so we need other people who are ready to go and lead churches, to appoint elders in every town. And so we have a plan as a church. But then let me make this very personal for you. Do you have a plan? Do you personally have a plan for discipling others? There should be a plan. It's not going to go well if you just think like, oh, it'll just be super organic. We'll just kind of like figure it out as we go. No, it will be tremendously helpful and biblical for you to say, I have a plan for how I'm going to disciple you. This is what it's going to look like. So how will you disciple your spouse? How will you disciple your kids, your discipline practicing partner? How will you disciple your home group, your friends, your coworkers, your enemies that you're called to love? How will you disciple them? Have a plan for that. Because there's an intentionality of the plan. And then lastly, there's an intentionality of the place. There's an intentionality of the place. Paul intentionally left Titus in Crete. The reason I left you in Crete, he says. There's a reason. You are in Crete for a reason, Titus. And this is what I want you to hear. You are in Claremont or Mineola or Oakland or Winter Garden or this whole greater Orlando area, wherever you live, you are here for a reason. It is not on accident that you find yourself where you are. You are here for a reason. This is our Crete. And we have been left here entrusted with this gospel here. And this is what Paul said in his message on Mars Hill. So Paul is in Athens. If you remember back to our study of the Acts of the Apostles, Paul is in Athens and he sees all these statues and everything, and there's one to the unknown God. And so he's preaching the gospel, and all the leading thinkers are like, hey, we want to hear this strange message that you're teaching. And so he gathers on what's called Mars Hill or the Areopagus. And this is what he says in the middle of his sermon. He said, "The God who made the world and everything in it, he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by hands. Neither is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives everyone life and breath and all things. Now listen to this. From one man, he has made every nationality to live over the whole earth and has determined their appointed times and the boundaries of where they live. He did this so they might seek God, and perhaps they might reach out and find him, though he is not far from each one of us." Did you hear that? God has established the time in which you will live. God has established the boundaries geographically in which you will live. You are here for a purpose. There is a purpose. There is a reason that you are here, and it is to make much of Jesus, and we do that through discipleship, helping others to grow in love and knowledge of our Lord. Multiplying. Seeing more and more come into this beautiful family of faith, this all to the glory of God. There's a reason you are here. There's an intentionality of the place that you here in this city, you have the privilege of proclaiming this gospel that God loves us in spite of our rebellion, in spite of our sin. He loves you so much so that he came in the form of Jesus. God the Son came and he took on humanity, still fully divine and yet fully human, and he lived a sinless life. He kept the law perfectly, and then he died the death that you and I deserve on a cross. And on that cross, he exchanged his righteousness with our sin, taking all of our guilt, all of our shame, all of our punishment on himself, and giving us his righteousness that it has been imputed to us. That now when God the Father looks at us, he sees Kevin, and he doesn't see me in my wretchedness. He delights in me, and he sees the righteousness of the Son of God whose blood covers me. And that is by faith, confessing him as Lord, that Jesus, you are God, and you lived the life that I could not live, and you died the death that I did deserve. But then he rose again victorious over death itself, because on the third day he raised from the dead, and he's alive forevermore, and he's offering forgiveness of sins and everlasting life to all who will believe. So will you believe? And then will you see that you are here, right here, so that you can proclaim that, you can share that beautiful good news with everyone, so that God would be glorified and sinners would be saved from their sin and the wrath of God that is to come. You're here for a purpose, and you've been entrusted with the gospel here. So will you make much of God and his good news? Because that is what you are here for. In your neighborhood, in your place of employment, in your position in life, in your literal location, you are here appointed by God for a reason. Will you live to that reason? Will you pray with me? Father, we thank you, God, that you would even allow us to be part of your story. God, that we could be saved at such a great cost. That it was your life. It was your blood, Jesus, that was spilled. But that was a joy to you. So God, let it be a joy for us to endure hardship. Let it be a joy to us to be persecuted. As we push forward, because you said your church would prevail. You said the gates of hell will not prevail against us, that we would advance. So God, let us advance here where you have brought us. And let us be faithful to share your word, to live out the holiness that you have called us to, that you are working in us, sanctifying us. Father, let it be. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.